Welcome to Setting Up for Success with Exchange Online Learning Path, Decommissioning On-Premises Exchange Server video with your hosts, Charlene Stevens and Chad Solars. Today, we'll be discussing how to have a stress-free removal of Exchange Server. In the process of migrating to Exchange Online, at some point, you'll need to reduce your on-premises footprint. Now, this should be an visible process to the end users. We all know that bad reputation can spread quickly, so a clean, thorough, non-impactful removal of Exchange Server is paramount. We want to ensure we're not leaving anything behind, either in the configuration or any artifacts in the directory services. So let's lay out a complete plan that we can successfully execute and make you look like the rock star that you are.
In this presentation, we'll discuss the way to align for a successful decom. We'll talk about considerations that you want to factor in and things that might cause hiccups along the way. We'll go through the stages of decom, and we'll tell a few stories about common missteps to help you avoid any issues. Next, let's talk about the decom don'ts. A common misstep we see often is attempting to test a decom of a server just by stopping the services. Unfortunately, this can cause other issues, and it isn't an effective test of decom. Those services are still considered available in Active Directory. Possible issues when stopping services you may experience are back pressure, which can halt mail flow. Some administrative functions will be impacted. For example, adding a mailbox permission can fail because WS Management Service is trying to connect to that server where the mailbox resides. Clients can still be proxied to those servers as well, and this could cause Outlook connectivity failures. Another issue we see that can cause problems is not removing antivirus before you attempt to uninstall Exchange. What can happen is AV may lock some files, causing an uninstall to be incomplete. You can end up with a partial uninstall of the server and have to manually make adjustments. Chad?
Now, far too often, we see or hear stories of you, the customer, having unrealistic timelines or expectations of how quickly or easily this whole process can be completed. So having this thorough plan will be the key to your success. Make sure it includes anything Exchange related. Now, what we're really meaning here is we'll want to include other stakeholders or integrators who may have dependencies or hooks into your Exchange server. You may be surprised to hear other services or applications have a reliance on your services that you weren't even aware of. Now, this could impact line of business applications. And what would the potential cost to the business be if something like this occurs? Now, once we're all done with the removal of Exchange, don't forget to circle back and rerun that hybrid configuration wizard. It will be auto-updating, so you'll always have the latest version of it. Now, this wizard will help us remove references to the old servers who are no longer participating in those hybrid operations.
Another important note to think about is third-party applications and integrations. There's many other programs that rely heavily on Exchange. We've already mentioned AV, but it's worth noting it again. There are so many other applications that can be impacted by removal of Exchange that we should consider digging further into these. Consider programs like backup agents, IIS extensions, ISAPI filters, archiving, fax, and so on. Another thing to consider is what third-party applications might be tied to POP or IMAP accounts or other accounts. So verify those clients can connect to Exchange Online or the newer version of Exchange prior to removing it. Now, let's move on to client access decom. If you're moving to a newer version of Exchange and not Exchange Online, it's important to verify that your server FQDNs and load balance devices are pointed to the new versions. For internal clients, the service connection point should also be moved to the newer version. Here are the examples of the commandlets you would use to check the location of the SCP and change the location. You would just use git-client-access-server using the auto-discover service internal URI, and then you can set it using set. Now let's move on to another slide related to decom of client access server. For the client, this slide, the client server decom is only specific to decom of 2010 if you're moving to a newer version of Exchange. Everyone may not have implemented Kerberos, but those of you that have, let's talk about possible impact if that's done incorrectly. Clients will fail to connect. This can have a huge impact, and we've seen hundreds of customers with this problem. The big takeaway from this slide is that 2010 cannot share an SPN with any of the newer versions. We must remove the http/autodiscover and http/domain.com SPN from the legacy version prior to implementing those SPNs on the newer version. You might ask, why will the clients fail to connect? This is because the client can obtain a Kerberos ticket from that older version and then attempt to pass that ticket to the new version. And that will fail because it's a bad ticket. Getting a bad ticket is one of those few scenarios where a client will not fall back to NTLM. This is very different from the client not being able to obtain a ticket, where in that case, we know they will fall back to NTLM. We've included a link to this slide. Please note step 4. That is the most commonly skipped section that leads to critical outage. Now let's discuss transport decom.
Thanks, Charlene. Now with transport decommissioning, specifically, we need to address the per server configurations and global configurations for mail flow. Now, this will focus on the per server configs, such as receive connectors, and those org-wide configs are send connectors. Now, these will need to be complete prior to actually performing the uninstallation itself. The installer tends to get a little angry if we haven't cleaned this up. Now, it's very likely you're using some custom send connectors or third-party or application-specific traffic via a connector. This can include the hybrid connectors as well. We'll want to ensure that we remove the server that is about to be removed from this configuration. On the receive connector side, these will include configurations listening on ports 25 or 587 for authenticated or anonymous traffic. Now here we see these are mostly used for purposes like application relay, notification processes for alerts, or multifunction devices that use services like scan to email. This configuration here will include the IP addresses as well as any permission groups that they may use. Here on the slide, we see some PowerShell examples on how to pull that information. Now this will need to be documented and then ported over to the newer version of Exchange or one of the remaining servers in the organization. Now we can use PowerShell, scripts, or just variables to lift those settings from the old and move them over to the new servers handling this load. Cannot stress this enough, but the most important part is to test this prior to removal. Use tricks like DNS host entries to try to force or massage the traffic towards the new servers that should be successfully handling this load. So now that we've discussed client access and transport, let's move on to mailbox decom. Now with these decommissioning steps, now we've also seen this during our normal upgrade processes, we should have already moved our special mailboxes to a remaining server. Now here we see how we can query for some of those special mailboxes, like with get-mailbox-arbitration, and then piping that into a move request to get it into a remaining database. Now these special mailboxes include system mailboxes, which are the framework for things like the approval processes, arbitration mailboxes, and any mailbox that may have special responsibilities, also known as our persisted capabilities. Think of our new OAB here. Now here we see some examples on how to move not just the mailboxes, but later on we'll also show you some public folder syntax that we can use. Now, once all of the mailboxes are vacated from the old databases, then we can go ahead and proceed. Now, it may not appear like it, but there really are some dependencies to the mailbox role, specifically those special mailboxes. And the last thing we want to do is impact end users or line of business applications just because of an uninstallation. Now, our OAB, we're specifically referencing the 2010 OAB here, was previously linked directly to the server object. So this will be going away. So let's make sure that we have a newer version that has an OAB with persisted capabilities tied to a new mailbox that is fully working. We'll also want to verify no remaining databases are referencing that older OAB. Now, last but not least, our public folders, everyone's favorite topic. Now, all public folders, whether they're the legacy 2010 folders or the newer modern public folders, we should still document fully. Now, in this example, we're querying for the public folders and exporting that information out to a text file or XML file. Now, once we have this listed out, we can use this as a confirmation system or validation step. This way, we can ensure that those public folders that need to stay on the remaining Exchange servers are active, accessible, and healthy. Ideally, we'd like to see this content moved possibly not just to newer Exchange servers, but obviously Exchange Online modern public folders. But let's not forget that we can also migrate this information to Microsoft 365 groups. Now, in the next phase, we'll go ahead and tackle breaking down the database availability group, or the DAG. Now, because we have highly available copies of the mailbox databases, we'll need to remove those additional copies before we can go ahead and proceed. Now, once we are down to a single copy, then we'll be allowed to remove that final copy. Now, remember, if we're going to be repurposing the server in any way, shape, or form, these files, the EDBs, the log files, are not cleaned up automatically for us. Now, once we have the databases removed, then we can go ahead and start breaking down the DAG. Now, here we can go ahead and remove membership. We can use the Exchange Admin Center or the browser-based UI or these PowerShell examples. Now, once the DAG object has no members anymore, then we can remove the DAG object itself from Exchange. Now, remember, if we're using a classic DAG or IP-based DAG, we will be later on required to clean up that cluster node object or CNO from Active Directory. All right, so let's go ahead and move on with Shar to talk about unified messaging and Edge Decom.
Thank you. Last but not least, if you're utilizing UM, you should already be moving to another option, such as cloud voicemail. We suggest that you remove all components related to UM, such as your dial plans, attendance, and other UM functions listed here. For Edge Decom, if you're planning to move to EXO, you should check Edge for any other functions that it might be doing, such as SMTP relay or any other connectors on it, before you decommission that server. If you're moving to a newer version of Exchange, you will need to recreate the subscriptions on the new version. Next, we will discuss uninstalling Exchange. Chad?
Thanks, Shar. So we're in that final phase. We're ready to start cleaning up the actual server itself. But after we've ran the setup.exe and we've removed all the roles from the server, now we actually have to clean the slate. Now, here is where we're going to make sure there are no references to that server left, both on DNS, Active Directory. So we're going to look for those lingering DNS entries, maybe any folder or share permissions that we use for the DAG, more specifically on the file share witness. Have we removed any version-specific routes or VIPs on the network or load balancing layers? Now, remember, we do not support firewall rules between Exchange servers. If you've had to create an all-all type of rule to allow that traffic between maybe data centers, these servers won't be leveraging that anymore. So we'll want to make sure that we go back and clean this up. So no server-specific or IP-specific configurations left behind. Now, once we have this all done, what are we going to do with the actual servers? If this is a physical machine, a 2U rack unit, what's our process for reclaiming that rack space? If we have a virtualized Exchange server, do we have access to the host? Is there another team or member we need to leverage to help us remove that virtual machine? Are we also then cleaning up the files, those VHDX files from those host machines? Let's make sure that we reclaim those resources to give to the other VMs as well. Now, this should be a clean, safe, graceful, and successful removal of Exchange if we followed this plan from front to back. Now, if this isn't working, we do support but not recommend the ADSI method of removing of the server from Active Directory. This should only be a last-ditch option. All other methods have failed. Now, to get more information on our series and our learning path focusing on setting up success with Exchange Online, please feel free to follow the following URL, aka.ms/microsoftignite2020/success-with-EXO. Now, if you wish to find out even more, we do have other paths and tracks that you may be interested in. Exchange, Outlook, time management, bookings, as well as mailbox protection. Thanks.